I reached into your book, and there's so many things that I need to ask you. Sometimes I'm afraid of what you might tell me. Sometimes I'm afraid that you'll tell me that this is not a work of fiction. I can only hope that the answers will come to me in my sleep. I hope that when the world comes to an end, I can breathe a sigh of relief, because there will be so much to look forward to.
Happy heresies, my beloved red pill takers. Welcome to your destiny of coffee, cigarettes, and gnosis, broadcast from the virtual Alexandria through the God above God that can. This is your life, don't play hard to get. This is your weekly manna of Gnostics, Gnosticism, and Gnosis, and their brethren in the esoterica. This is your dark odyssey through the gnashing rocks of Orthodoxy as we climb our way slowly towards the treasury of light and away from the chimera of the Matrix, the Truman Show set, the Donnie Darko neighborhood, the Dark City, Chicago-esque noir quarter, or that 13th floor. Take your pick. It's all the same, my beloved true seekers.
I was going to the worst place in the world, and I didn't even know it yet.
This is approximately Saturday, November 10th, and I am Abraxas, the God above God as the ancients knew him, and, as I've mentioned before, the origin from where we get the word abracadabra. Add my words together in Greek gematria, and you get 365, meaning I am a solar logos, a mediator between the earthly and the transcendental, a being that is all and nothing at the same time, a being that is everything that was and everything that has not been imagined yet. I am also with you all year long in spirit and in voice.
From hell's heart, I stab at thee.
While I walk the razor's edge between scholarly pontification and New Age babble, make sure you've got some fuel in your cup and some tobacco substance to burn. Light a cancer stick, an illegal cigar, your best sandalwood incense, or maybe even your brother's farts. Light up your heart light like Neil Diamond sang, because that's where you'll find the astral fire of the alchemists.
Coffee's for closers only.
Things are looking real horror show with the Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis movie. It's already in production, if you hadn't already read it in Variety magazine. Either Mark Singer or Kelsey Grammer will play me when CGI isn't making me into Abraxas. Snake feet, rooster or falcon head, naked human torso, a shield in one hand and a multi-headed whip with stars on the other. And I'm sure the chariot with the flying white horses will look just as cool. We're very close in getting Demi Moore to play my love interest. In fact, I've got her on the phone right now for a short interview. Hey Demi, are you ready for to have lunch with me at the hottest restaurant in town so we could talk some business?
Suck my dick!
Jeez, watch your damn language. This is a family show. Let me repeat myself if there's too much Botox in your ears. Are we on for Hello? 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 Bah, I'll get our agent to take care of it. I believe Ian McKellen will be playing the villain while my bumbling sidekick, my Cephas Peter, will be Chris O'Donnell. It's not like he has anything better to do these days since Batman and Robin. The film will be a dozy, directed by James Cameron and produced by the Wachowski brothers who brought you The Matrix and V for Vendetta. And, what? What? My producers, my children Alexander and Sophia, are telling me that there was a confidentiality clause on the whole thing. Seems I'm in hot water. Fine, kids, I'll start the show.
Freaking idiot!
Yes. Was what I said deception, or was it a new room in the myth that is my life? Does it matter in the end? Not really, but endless speculation, constant reinterpretation, furious rewriting is a keystone in the existence of any Gnostic or lover of the esoterica. The last thing we want to do is get bogged down in the literalism of orthodoxy that freezes our spiritual cells and stunts our psychological growth potential. Like St. Paul wrote, the letter killeth, the spirit giveth life. With that said, we create a new room for a myth in one of the most important early Christian findings since the Nag Hammadi library rose from the sands of Egypt. the same exact year nuclear warfare was used against mankind in Japan, and that was 1945.
There are no coincidences, Delia. Only the illusion of coincidence.
And that is the Gospel of Judas, so many of you heard about in 2006. You know, the one pimped by National Geographic. The one that confirmed our suspicions that Judas was not an evil Jewish villain, but one who took a hit for the heavenly team. The one that Pope Benedict warned us not to read on his Easter address. It's also the one that many of our leading scholars, such as Bart Ehrman, Karen King, Elaine Pagels, James Robison, just to name a few, have wrapped best-selling books around. Money for nothing and your gnosis for free.
Well, the outrages I have suffered today will not be soon forgotten. I will not be forgetting those outrages. No, no! No, they won't be forgotten. Not
outrages,
the outrages.
Yeah, I think we got it.
Oh.
But what would happen if there is an alternative message to this Gnostic gospel? What if variations, contextual discrepancies, and simple errors gave us a very different reading? What if balls were dropped like those of a maturing dog and the public got carried away with a vision of Judas like he appears in The Last Temptation of Christ or Jesus Christ Superstar? What if the Gnostic Judas was far worse than the Orthodox Judas? Not just an incarnation of Brutus or Lady Macbeth, but an actual demonic henchman working for the god of this world. And perhaps even worse, because the archons in Gnosticism are said to be ignorant, but the incubus Judas has both gnosis and evil within him. Pretty scary, isn't it?
Thus I clothe my naked villainy with old odd ends, stolen forth from holy writ, and seem a saint when most I play the devil.
And the scholar who first discovered these startling revelation is our guest today, April DeConick, who contends this maleficent Judas in her new book, The 13th Apostle. I was personally yet sensually shocked, pleased at a new wrinkle in the Gnostic mythos, and thrilled with her keen yet approachable scholarship. At first, I felt I'd been had by National Geographic, but then realized that there is often so much gray, the best we can do is find our own light in the perspective of the information we are given.
It's not what you know, it's what you can prove.
In other words, don't judge like the ancient church fathers did, but simply find a comfort zone and balance all the mythologems you are given. Speculate, reinterpret, and rewrite the map of the pleroma that is in your heart. The devil is in the details, but salvation is in the sum total of the epic of you following the thing called bliss. Allow me to read one page of April's book, The 13th Apostle, so that you may get a better feel of the engaging interview coming up.
Yes!
Several weeks into my translation project, the sensationalistic interpretation began to trouble me thoroughly. The translation choice made by the National Geographic team appeared to me to have led to the erroneous conclusion that Judas is a saint destined to join the holy generation of the Gnostics. The result is that certain claims have been made by National Geographic that the Gospel of Judas says certain things. Thing it just does not say. Number 1, Judas is the perfect enlightened Gnostic. Number 2, Judas ascends to the holy generation. Number 3, Jesus wants Judas to betray him. Number 4, Jesus wants to escape the material world. Number 5, Judas performs a righteous act, serving Jesus by betraying him. Number 6, Judas will be able to enter the divine realm as symbolized by his vision of the great house. Number 7, as the 13th, Judas surpasses the 12 disciples and is lucky and blessed by this number.
Inconceivable!
It appears to me that the National Geographic team analysis has been further compromised because of a number of the things that the Gospel of Judas really says have been either neglected or misunderstood. And these are, number 1, Judas is a demon. Number 2, Judas will lament and mourn his fate. Number 3, Judas' seed controls the archons instead of being controlled by them. Number 4, Judas is separated from the holy generation. Number 5, Judas will not ascend to the holy generation. Number 6, Judas cannot enter the heavenly house he has seen in his vision. And number 7, Judas does the worst thing he can do by sacrificing Jesus. The bottom line, the Gospel of Judas does not portray Judas as a hero or as a Gnostic. What it does, however, is equally fascinating. it provides a mid-second century Gnostic parody of Judas and his story, a parody that pokes fun at traditional Christian doctrines and practices. And Judas, well, he is as evil as ever. So you can see that perhaps there has been either a terrible misunderstanding or there is wonderful opportunity. It doesn't matter in the end, only the gnosis either Judas sparks in you matters. For a good balance, I, of course, recommend that you listen to Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis number 39 on the Gospel of Judas with Marvin Meyer, who was, of course, one of the original translators of the work itself. Meyer gives us an inspirational, erudite, and adoring version of his Gospel of Judas. Check it out, my beloved True Seekers, and equalize it with what we present to you today. Make up your own minds, transform your souls, and at the end of the day know that it is a secret smile you cannot express or even understand that is the mark of the enlightened one. But like heaven above you, the spy that loved you, know that Abraxas keeps all these secrets safe for you tonight, and every night, and for all eternity until you are ready to ascend to the seat of the gods that have been reserved for you since before the beginning of time.
You mean the devil won't show up?
We are the Gnostics. We write our own gospels and live our own myths. Like Joseph Campbell said, myth is becoming transparent to the transcendental. And like Mary Magdalene, our earthly incarnation of Sophia, says in the Nag Hammadi Library Dialogue of the Savior, there is but one saying I will speak to the Lord concerning the mystery of truth. In this have we taken our stand, and to the cosmic are we transparent. Let us become more transparent so that the Pleroma consume us with our interview with April DeConick on the new translation of the Gospel of Judas.
You see, I believe that when we leave a place, part of it goes with us. And part of us remains. Go anywhere in the station when it is quiet and just listen. After a while, you will hear the echoes of all our conversations, every thought and word we've exchanged. Long after we are gone, our voices will linger in these walls. As long as this place remains. But I will admit that the part of me that is going will very much miss the part of you that is staying.
This is the Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis interview. With us today, we've got April DeConick talking about her new book, The 13th Apostle. How are you doing today, April?
Very good. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for being on and taking your time. So why don't we get to your very eye-opening and controversial book, at least from how the first splash it's had. But when was the exact moment you realized that something was rotten in Denmark when it came to the first translation of the Gospel of Judas?
I remember the moment very clearly, actually. I was with my husband, and we just finished watching the documentary that National Geographic put out on the Gospel of Judas. And I was excited, thinking that we'd finally found the Gospel of Judas, and it had a hero figure in it. And so I went to the computer, and I printed out the English translation of the text and the Coptic transcription that National Geographic had uploaded. And I read through the English rather quickly, and I turned to my husband as my stomach just sank, and I said, oh my gosh, there's something really wrong here. Judas is working for Sakhlos, the Demiurge. That started it for me. The next day I went in my office and started working through the Coptic itself, and came across several issues of translation differences that I had with the National Geographic team.
Just by listening, reading the English translation, the bells and whistles went on in you, inside of you?
It did. Wow. It did. Mm-hmm. When I came across the passage where Jesus is explaining to Judas about sacrificing and how horrific it is, and that Soklos was being sacrificed to. The text breaks at that point, and you have several lines that are missing, and then it comes back with Judas, with Jesus telling Judas, and Judas, you're going to do the worst of all. You're going to sacrifice me. That I knew that just from reading it in the English, that he was going to be sacrificed to Soklos.
Why, I guess the burning questions a lot of people will certainly have is, why do you think the translators missed what seems to be obvious contextual truths about the Gospel of Judas? Where do they drop the ball?
I think there are probably several reasons. I haven't talked to any of them directly to ask them that question, so I really can't say from their perspective why. It could just be just simple error. But I think that they may have gone into the project with some preconceptions about what was supposed to be in the Gospel of Judas. One of the church fathers, Epiphanius, records that the Gospel of Judas belonged to a group that he calls the Canaanites. And they elevate Judas to a power, a high power from the Aeons. And that this high power was all knowledgeable, and he descended and was meant to bring about Jesus' death at the moment when Jesus would be too weak to go through with it. And I think that that expectation may have colored the way that they read and interpreted this text initially. You know, psychologists tell us how our preconceptions, can really make us see things that maybe not there or in different light and that sort of thing. So that may have been going on. The other problem, and this is just a kind of a procedural issue, is that when National Geographic became involved, they selected a few scholars to work on this and then made them sign non-disclosure statements so that the scholars couldn't talk to anybody outside the team. And so there was no way to really double check what you were doing with people, that were not working for National Geographic. Any sort of, initial misreading or error would then just be generated further in the literature as people started to, work on it and write on it outside of National Geographic once the original transcription was released. So that's the second problem, and just they weren't allowed to talk about it with other scholars.
Do you think, April, that maybe were they trying to rush the job? Do you think that might have been it, or were they given as much time as they wanted?
Now I do know they were rushed. I've been told that by one of the members of the team, that they were rushed to complete the project, and that they, wanted to wait and do more work on the text, but they were forced to make this deadline in April of 2006 with their translation and their transcription. And if you actually look, I don't know if it's still posted, but the original transcription of the Coptic that was posted, it says on there, this is a provisional transcription. It's still a work in progress. But that didn't seem to stop scholars from using it to write their own books without it being reviewed as a transcription by other scholars. Does that make sense?
Yes, perfectly.
Uh-huh. Okay. And the other thing they did is, because National Geographic wanted this exclusive publication into English and several other languages, is that they didn't wait to fix and finish the transcription before they made the English popular English translation. So they just released this popular translation when the text wasn't ready to go.
And since then, you talk about in your book how you have encountered Marvin Meyer and stuff. Have you had any friction with the original translators of the Gospel of Judas, whether person to person or email or what they've said?
No, these are actually good friends of mine, at least. I consider them to be good friends and colleagues. Usually we're pretty cordial together. We can have our disagreements, and that can be okay. There, it's rare that scholars actually really agree on a text in all ways. So it's always a situation where it's being discussed. The text is being discussed, and this isn't any different, except that I think it's more public because of National Geographic's involvement, and it's a new text, so that tends to make it more provocative and so forth.
Could you set the stage of the Gospel of Judas at the time in reference of the two competing Christianities of the time, the Apostolic Christians and the Sethian Gnostics?
Sure. Christianity in the mid-second century was really quite a diverse movement. It had a lot of competing communities. They weren't always in competition. They were different. Some of them saw themselves as competing with other traditions, but not all of them. The Apostolic Christians are what we come to know of as the mainstream Christians. But at the time in the mid-second century, there wasn't a mainstream Christianity. There were many varieties of it. And they were all in some way jostling to become the dominant tradition. And they employed various techniques in their literature and so forth in order to get the upper hand. And we can see that in the this happening in the writings of the Church Fathers, but we can also see it in the Gnostic materials as well. So what we have is a variety of Christianities. Some of them are tied in more closely with the Apostolic Christians, and some of them are counter-movements. The Sethians were a counter-movement to the Gnostic or to the Apostolic Christians, and they had a completely different way of interpreting Christian scripture as well as Jewish scripture. They tended to interpret things in reverse of the way the traditional interpretation may have read a passage. So the Genesis story, for instance, Eve is actually a good figure who receives gnosis, a knowledge about God and about her own divinity, from the snake, who is also a good figure. And these folks are working in opposition to the Yahweh God, who is read by the Sethians as the demiurge, as a lesser God, and a God who is an opponent to the Supreme Father. And when the demiurge is acting in history, his actions are such that he's trying to stop human beings from knowing the God above and returning to the God above. And so he's attempting to suppress that knowledge and to keep that secret from human beings. And so there are a lot of stories in which they will read these biblical stories kind of backwards. And that's what's going on with the Gospel of Judas. The Judas materials are being read in reverse. Another aspect of the Sethians compared to the mainstream or apostolic Christians is that they had different, completely different ritual set. They performed something called a practice called the Five Seals, and we're not quite sure what it involved, but kind of pieces from their literature, we can tell that it was some sort of water rituals were involved, where they were immersing people several times. They were anointing people. And there were a lot of prayers and chants and that sort of thing involved in the ritual. And what it was some sort of initiation ceremony in which the initiate was being taken out of this realm and out of basically the entire cosmic realm and into the aeons and the pleroma in order to meet the angels there and to be guided up into the highest of the spheres. So the Sethians did not attend apostolic churches. Rather, they had their own sort of church community, which I understand to be more of like a lodge in which they worked on study of text, prayer, contemplation, initiation, and that sort of thing.
And do you think the Sethians really revered Christ, or do you think a lot of their works were Christianized later on, that Seth was always the main character? Or did they understand that Jesus was the, you know,
kind of a Seth figure.
Yes, Seth Redivivus or something like
that. Yeah, no, that's a really disputed question that you're asking me.
I know, John Turner's talked a lot about
really
that.
Yeah, it's a fantastic question, and I actually do have a really strong opinion on that. For me, the Sethian materials are probably our oldest Gnostic materials, and they look to me as if they go back to Alexandria in the first century. And I think it was initially just a Jewish movement. It was, a lodge movement that had some connections with the Hermetic lodges that were in Alexandria at this time. Eventually, the Christians, when they came on board, began attending the lodge as well. And so you do see then Christianization of these materials. But I think the movement was initially a Jewish movement. This means that you can have, in a Sethian lodge, you can have people meeting of more than one tradition. They may be Jewish, they may be Christian, but it kind of shows us a diverse community.
April, could you give us maybe before we move on, a quick recap on what exactly occurs in the Gospel of Judas?
Sure. The text opens with a bit of narration about Jesus comes and goes among the disciples and so forth. And then the first scene in which he is actually teaching and doing things is a Eucharist scene, in which the disciples are sitting around and performing Eucharist. And Jesus comes and laughs at them. And the laugh is not a celebratory laugh. It's a mocking sort of laugh, because the disciples respond by saying to Jesus, but we've done what's right. Why are you laughing at us? And Jesus then tells them that he's laughing because the offering that they're making is an offering to the demiurge, to the to Yaldabaoth, Sakhalus, and Nebuel. And so that's your first scene. In that scene, you also get a confession scene in which the 12 disciples err in their confession of Jesus, while Judas steps forward and pronounces that he's from Barbelo, the great mother Aeon. And Jesus then tells him that he will reveal the mysteries of the kingdom to him, not so that he'll go to the kingdom, but so that he will lament very greatly. You get a scene that in which Jesus, and he leaves then. And then when he returns, the 12 disciples tell him about a vision, dream vision that they had, like a collective dream vision. And I think it's the way the text is saying that, you know, see how great we are. We've had this vision of us now. And they're not quite sure how the vision should be interpreted, and they're a little bit disturbed about the contents of the dream. So this dream vision they have is of the 12 priests sacrificing on the altar at the temple. And they compare they tell Jesus that they're killing babies and they're on the altar and their wives. And I mean, it's just, you know, quite nasty. And then Jesus tells them that they are the 12 priests who are committing the sacrilege, and that they are committing it to Yaldabaoth. We get the next scene. Judas then comes to Jesus and says that he's had this great vision, thinking that, you know, that he's better than the 12. And he tells Jesus that he saw the 12 disciples were stoning him, and so he ran away from them, and he came to a beautiful house full of prominent people. And he says to Jesus, let me enter that house. Clearly, Judas understands the dream to mean that he'll transcend the 12, and that he, you know, he's so great that he'll be able to be part of the kingdom and the glorious aeons. And Jesus tells him at that point, you've misunderstood this dream. Only the holy ones are able to be part of the kingdom, and that you will be come the 13th diamond or demon, and you will rule over the 12. And then, of course, Jesus laughs at this, again, a mocking laugh. The text continues with Jesus giving revelation to Judas. These are specific Sethian revelations about cosmology. And then at the end of this revelation part of the text, Jesus tells Judas, again, he repeats that his star belongs to the 13th realm, and that he will be a ruler over the 12 disciples. And then he says, there's some talk about, as I said earlier, sacrificing to how bad sacrifices, and the 12 disciples are making these terrible sacrifices to Soklos. We have that break in the text, and then he says to Judas, but you're going to do the worst sacrifice because you're going to sacrifice, you know, me. And then we get a fragmented piece where someone, and we're not sure if it's Judas or Jesus, ascends into a cloud, and then the text ends with a turn to scripture where the a passage from Mark is being addressed, where Jesus is in a house and Judas is going to betray him. And that's how the text ends.
Yeah, and that's telling in itself, because as you mentioned in your book, the Gospel of Mark is also very anti-apostle.
Very much. Mm-hmm. Very much. The Gospel of Mark is not often noticed by this, is not often noticed to be so negative about the 12 disciples. But if you really just sit down with it and you forget how Matthew has rewritten the story, and you forget how Luke has rewritten the story, and you just look at Mark and track the disciples, they are ignorant throughout the text. They never do get it, even in the longer ending of Mark, which I find fascinating. I'm not sure what that means, but it is interesting. And Jesus calls them the faithless. So they don't fare well in this text. And the only people who know Jesus in the text are the demons. So I think we've got in the Gospel of Judas a play off of the Gospel of Mark, because there, you know, the demons know Jesus. Judas knows who he is in the Gospel of Judas. The 12 disciples are very ignorant and never know what's going on. And we have the same kind of thing going on in Judas. The Gospel of Judas.
And the other clue too, which you just mentioned, which is amazing anybody missed, but the number 13, Judas being the 13th apostle in the 13th heaven, is actually a very bad thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I think that's the key. I think that number 13 is the key to really unlocking this text. In Sethian tradition, the number 13th is tied to Yaldabaoth. He's called the God of the 13th realms. It's as if it's his nickname. And to call Judas the 13th diamond or 13th demon, it means you're calling him Yaldabaoth. I mean, to any Sethian reader, that's what you're doing. And so that was missed by the initial interpreters and translators is, I think, really problematic.
Yeah, I agree. Maybe they just got lost because you know how St. Paul is called the 13th apostle sometimes, and it's just...
yeah, you're right. It has been used for other. I think Constantine too is known as the 13th apostle in tradition, but it certainly has its use in early Christianity. In fact, Irenaeus, there's a piece from him which he's actually talking about the Valentinians and how they elevate the 12 apostles to become aeons. And he's really upset about this, and because of what it might suggest about Judas. And so he says that, well, you know, their numerology is wrong because we all know that Judas is the 13th apostle. And it seems to be a numerology that a number associated with Judas that was common in early Christianity. But the Sethians are using it in a real specific way in this text to hook him to that demiurge figure.
And why don't we look at some of the other mistranslations that you were able to catch. The most blatant one, and you've kind of touched upon it, is the one that the National Geographic translation called Judas a spirit, but he's really called a demon, isn't he?
Right. The word is daimon that is used here. And I've gone back and tracked that word through the Christian and Gnostic literature in particular, and there's 52 instances of it being used in the non-commodity literature, and every single one is being it refers to an archon or one of the archons, nasty angels, you know, that they create, something like that. It's the malicious powers, the negative powers of the cosmic realm. Those are the daimons in Gnostic literature. They're not spirits in the sense of a good spirit.
And you think it was the National Geographic, you say that what they made the mistake is they used the classic Greek term for a diamond, like Socrates believed
right.
in a diamond, in a daemon, a higher self. Is that what they did?
Exactly. They and that's in a footnote, actually, in their translation where they try to explain it, because it's unusual. It would be unusual to translate this word as spirit in Christian and especially Gnostic literature. So they do try to hook it back to Plato. But when you do that, I mean, you're going back 500 years in time, and the word has taken on a certain nuance and meaning within our Gnostic literature that might be a bit different from Hellenistic literature. Although the Hellenistic literature in the late period does tend to connect the daimons with the lower forces that are around in the cosmos that tend to be more negative. So there is even a movement in the Greek literature to do this.
And also in the first translation of the Gospel of Judas, it states that Judas will be a star. And, you know, Plato said also, we are all stars,
exactly.
and so forth. But your translation actually makes him a fool for fate. How did you come about this?
Well, the star reference is really important, because in Jewish tradition and then also in Christian and Gnostic tradition, stars are connected to angels. The stars in the heavens are the angels in the heavens, and the planets are angels, or in the case of Gnostic tradition, they're demons. So that the notion that he's connected with that particular star is important, because that, again, is hooking him with that realm. What happens in the Gnostic traditions is that people who are not Gnostics, and here I'm talking about Sethians, okay, I'm not going to talk about Valentinians, but Sethians, people who are not Gnostics will always remain under the fate of the stars. The stars, the demons that control this world, will always be controlling their lives. There's no way for them to get released from that. The only people that can get out of it are the Gnostics who've gone through a particular, the five-seal ritual, which liberates them and allows them to overcome their fate. Now, what's really interesting is that the apostolic Christians believe that through baptism, that the Christians overcame the fate, and that they would be given a new fate, that they would be reborn and so forth. But what the Sethian Gnostics were saying is, your baptism really doesn't work. You really stay under the fate of the stars always, while we don't, because we have the right ritual.
But the Sethians did believe in baptism as well.
These water rituals were baptism rituals, but unlike the apostolic Christians, what they were doing is multiple baptisms. And I like to compare it to Mandean ritual, because there you have a modern example of sort of a multiple baptismal ritual, where the person will go into the river, they'll be immersed or have water splashed on them several times, and then they will come up to the shore and they go through a little ritual meal and anointing ceremony. And this happens frequently in their life. So it's not just a one-time deal like it is in the apostolic church.
We get from the first translation that Judas sacrificing Jesus is a good thing, because it releases his spirit from his body and allows Jesus to go back to the aeons. But you say that Judas sacrificing Jesus to the archons is really a negative thing.
Sacrifice in this text is not a good thing. Okay, so I mean it's a horrific act, and it's always done to the archons. This was a way, of course, for the writers here to criticize apostolic Christianity in terms of the Eucharist ritual, and also in terms of atonement theories about Jesus' death. This doesn't mean, however, that the Sethian authors didn't have a theory, I think, about Jesus' death. In fact, when Jesus died. It was not meant, it was, the Sethian author doesn't understand it to be a sacrifice. What he understands it to be is a release of Jesus' spirit so he can conquer the archonic powers. Now, that so that, I think that aspect of Gnostic tradition needs to be, I guess, separated from each other. In other words, the apostolic Christians were saying Jesus' death is a sacrifice, and there's an atoning benefit for that. And the Sethian Gnostics were saying, no, his death isn't a sacrifice, at least not to the high God, because the high God would never commit infanticide. So, but what his death means is that his spirit was released and could conquer the powers. How Judas is involved in that in the Sethian story is that he is a demon and he works for Yaldabaoth, the demon, or somehow his alter ego or something like that. And he is working to stop any sort of redemption that God might have in mind with Jesus. And so he's trying to kill Jesus before Jesus can do whatever God has set out for him to do. When this happens, though, Jesus' spirit is released, and this turns out to be a trick on the archons and on Judas, because they didn't know that that was going to happen. And then that release actually conquers them. So the interpretation's a bit different from the Sethian perspective.
Yeah, and also you mentioned in your book, it's pretty ironic, and I wonder why they did it, but even if Judas is a bad guy, he still is the one who gets it, right?
Yeah, and the 12
he has gnosis.
Don't.
Yeah.
Right? He gets it and the 12 don't. And when this is, again, this is a criticism, again, of the apostolic Christians saying, you guys are all following people that are so ignorant that even Judas the demon knows more than they did. And I think that that's quite sophisticated in terms of argument.
Yeah, which ties back to the Gospel of Mark, where it's the demons who get Jesus of all people.
Exactly.
Do you think maybe the Sethians not only were against the apostolic church and the whole atonement, but they were probably in the beginning also against animal sacrifice in the Second Temple, weren't they? Do you think maybe, John Turner says maybe that's the reason why they split off?
It could very well be. The sacrifice is just not a good thing in Sethian text.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's interesting that you should bring that up because, you know, in Christian tradition, there is a tradition that is, we call a Jewish Christian tradition of the Edenites, that they also talk about Jesus's teachings in terms of anti-sacrifice, that Jesus is the true prophet, came in order to denounce the temple sacrificial system. So that's interesting because that's a Jewish movement too.
April, going back to the mistranslations, the one big theme is that Judas will ascend to the holy generation.
Right.
But in your version, you say that he will not ascend to the holy generation. What's the difference there?
Well, the difference is that the National Geographic team fabricated a line. What they did is they amended a line by eliminating the negative not. It's a difficult line because the line right before it doesn't connect up grammatically with the line that follows it. And so they worked on the line in order to make it read contiguous. And in order to do that, they had to amend the text. And when they amended it, they dropped the negative. But when you go back and look at the manuscript, what happened is that that end of that line has some sort of scribal error to the next line. In other words, when this text was being copied by a scribe or translated or something, the scribe missed a couple lines. And so the end of that one line doesn't match up now with the beginning of the next line, and you just have to leave it at that. And when you leave it at that and you don't amend the text, you have the text actually says Judas will not ascend to the holy generation. Now, thankfully, the critical edition that National Geographic put out this summer has changed that. So they have rescinded the emendation they made. Of course, the problem is that scholars that were initially, you know, quickly publishing on this were publishing based on the faulty transcription and making all sorts of interpretive leaps based on that faulty transcription that had been made.
Yeah, I guess the one example would be Elaine Pagels and Karen King's book. They worked off the old translation when they wrote their book.
Yeah, they accepted that emendation, and so Judas ascends in their text. Bart Ehrman the same. That's very problematic, because now we know that the text does not say that anywhere in the text.
And do you think maybe people watching the Last Temptation of Christ might have influenced them? I think you mentioned that in your book.
Yeah.
As he's such a great Judas, you know?
He is a great Judas, and we all love that Judas. But that Judas is not in the Gospel of Judas.
Neither is the one from Jesus Christ Superstar.
No. No, that one neither.
And what exactly separates the Sethian Jesus from the Orthodox Jesus? I think one thing you point out is that Jesus just kind of appears when he wants to appear, mm-hmm. like a spirit of sorts.
He does. That does not mean, however, that he was not understood by them to be a real human being. I think this is a misconception that has been just generated in the secondary literature, unfortunately. The Sethian Jesus is a great aeon, and he descends through all the cosmic realms, invisible or in disguise, so that nobody knows that so the archons don't know that anything is up. And what they do notice is when suddenly they see this human being down on earth starting to preach. And they don't like what he's saying, because it sounds like he knows something about the Supreme God. And so they want to try to stop whatever that activity is, which, of course, again, they don't know, but they want to stop him. And that's when they decide to kill him and implement Judas in that process. Of course, this is maybe not so different from the apostolic Christians, who also think that Jesus was preexistent as some sort of a great angel or great power or God himself, and descends down into flesh and teaches and is killed. So yeah, there are a lot of points that are I think more similar than different a story.
For some listeners that might not understand, obviously the Gospel of Judas doesn't mention Sophia, but it does mention Barbelo. Who exactly is Barbelo? She's very important, obviously.
Yeah. Actually, I think that Sophia is mentioned once in the Gospel of Judas.
Oh, okay.
But Barbelo is the mother figure. She's the mother Aeon. And she and the father, she comes from the father. And then they produce the son, who is, and that makes up in the Sethian cosmology, the Pleroma. And each of these great Aeons has several other aeons that they produce within their realm where they're existing.
And do we know what her name means? I've heard about 10 different definitions of her name. What do you think her name means?
You know, I don't think that has been resolved at all in scholarship. These names, from what I've been able to tell, are usually some sort of exegetical exercise. They've found some word in the Hebrew or the Aramaic materials that indicates the name of a god, and then starts becoming used in a different language, and so the vowels shift and the consonants shift, and so pretty soon you end up with something that's a bit far removed from what has started. And that's what I imagine happened here, although I cannot tell you what the original name was. But I think Yaldabaoth is one of those examples. It probably meant Lord of Hosts or something like that, and it ends up becoming just garbled through verbal transmission and translation into other language.
Yeah, in other words, we'll never know.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard to prove those things.
And what most also listeners might not know, but weren't there other books or codices also found along with the Gospel of Judas?
Yes, the Gospel of Judas is part of a bigger book that was found. It's being called by a modern designation the Takis Codex, after Frida Takis, who is the antiquities dealer who bought the book and got National Geographic involved in the restoration process. But in that book, right now, we know there we have the a second copy of the Letter of Peter to Philip, which is also in the Nag Hammadi Library. And the second copy is very fragmentary. We have also a second copy of a book that that in the Takis Codex is called just simply James, but it is a second version of the first apocalypse of James that we have in Nag Hammadi. That text is really full and complete, and it's wonderful because it's complete in areas that the Nag Hammadi text is not. So I think that we're really going to have a fantastic understanding of this text once we, you know, study it and do some comparisons with Nag Hammadi. There is a fragmented text that they're calling Oligonase, which is unfortunate because that is also the name of a text from Nag Hammadi, but it doesn't appear to be the same text. It's something different. This Oligonase is very fragmented. We only have the piece of it, and the piece we have looks to me like it is a Gnostic revisionary, a Gnostic rewrite of the temptation story. So Satan is there, and he's tempting this figure called Oligonase, which makes me wonder if Oligonase is actually the foreigner, is actually the Aeon Jesus. So that should be interesting to talk about in the future. And then it appears that there was a fragment, maybe even the full text of Corpus Hermeticum chapter 13.
Oh, wow.
There's just a fragment of that that we know of, but it looks like that it comes from that. There may have been even more of Corpus Hermeticum in the Takis Codex. We just don't know. There are 50 fragments of the Takis Codex that are still outstanding. National Geographic has photographs of them. They have not been published. They have not been released to other scholars. Apparently, these fragments are physically in Ohio, and I don't have any idea when or if we'll ever get to see those, but that appears to be the rest of the Takis Codex. So this thing was huge. In other words, I think we only have about half of it.
And isn't there one of the letters of St. Paul in there, too?
Then what we have, there were three other books along with the Takis Codex. One of them was the Letters of Paul. That book has not been recovered from the market. I don't know if it was destroyed or if somebody's got it and we don't know about it, but that has not been recovered yet. But we know that it exists because it was seen by, I believe, Stephen Emmel. There is also a book of Exodus. And that book is apparently a really important translation of Exodus. It was torn up into pieces and sold off to various places, I mean, many different places. And so there's a website now, and I don't have a name, but there's a website that's collecting, like, where all the different pieces of this manuscript are. And then there was a mathematical treatise that's a geometrical treatise, I believe. So four books, and then in the Takis Codex, I think we only have about half of it. The Gospel of Judas, Letter of Peter to Philip, First Apocalypse of James, Oligonase, and Corpus Hermeticum 13.
Well, April, I think that's all the time we have today. I'd really like to thank you for coming on and giving us such a wonderful interview.
Thank you very much for having me.
Pleasure's all mine, and good luck with the book.
Thank you. Bye. Cool.
Out of the darkness, living Eve, lush pomegranates, ripe figs, ready for tasting, heaving upon the branches. What is it that is secreted away? Rua? Sheltered Spiritus? Stolen Sophia? sweet fruit in your hands, gnosis in the bite, juice on the chin. Hide away, Eve, the nemesis of God is upon you.
And that is a poem by our astral guest, April DeConick, entitled The Garden, which you can find at the Gnostic magazine, or journal, as Andrew insists on calling it when he's not fighting Irish blasphemy laws. And that is found in issue number 2.
Do not panic! Do not panic! We are trained professionals!
Ah, lady has the brains, talents, and looks, my beloved truth seekers. And more. April has that musical ear Hans Jonas wrote about in The Gnostic Religion. That special ear that must be finely tuned and perfected to understand, decipher the ghostly canticles of the classic Gnostics as they call out us from their unavenged graves and torn pages of history thrown in the waste baskets of censorship by those ostentatious victors and their eyes wide shut with the crust of ignorance and pride.
And may the Christian Lord guide my hand against your Roman popery!
And this is certainly Aeon Byte, broadcast at the virtual Alexandria through the God Above God Dad Cam. Welcome with kindness and love to a place where you can be more than you've allowed yourself to be, where you can shine on like a crazy diamond, reach the paradises of your divine potential. I hope you've got some planned substance to burn, a smoldering sacrifice to the uncaring Aztec gods that strickens and destroys your precious body, that Promethean fire of Gnosis that chains you to be tortured by the vultures of society, that castigating sun heat that melts the Icarus wings of your ego and allows you to fall into the oceans of the collective unconscious. And certainly some fuel in your cup, something that turns your blood into battery acid, stimulates your mind into Red Bull paranoia, that heightens your third eye into finally seeing the men in black behind the curtains of the universal Oz.
This is your life, and it's ending 1 minute at a time.
And all this because coffee is for closers, and we're already burning because, like Jesus says in the Gospel of Thomas, he has cast fire on the world, and now he watches it blaze in order to get those Gorgon rats to come out of the sewers of the cosmos and the sewers of your soul.
I reveal myself to myself, and I am drenched and purged.
And we are the Gawain Gnostics, the Bacchian free thinkers, and the consorts of the esoterica. We are the eternal Israelites, wandering in the metaphysical deserts of the Lord of Hosts, tired of his Twinkie manna and stupid carnival pillars of false light, waiting until he flinches in those moments when he realizes his machine called reality is broken, loses himself in one of his self-important Isaiah-type speeches, so we can quickly run back to where we belong. Ancient Kemet, where the Aeonic alchemists, Schrodinger pharaohs, and laughing hermeticists await our return. We, the archetypal Odysseus, lost for so long in the seas of fate, and prodigal sons and daughters of the Emerald Tablet of Thoth.
Welcome to the real world.
Yes, we're on an eternal Battlestar Galactica, crossing the vast emptiness of existence, the Kanoma or Samsara, daring the silence of perdition that often infiltrate our very identities in order to murder our individuality, searching for a blue sphere of hope where we shall be actualized in our primordial states of creatures of pure virgin light substance.
I am God.
Of course, with our luck, this ship, the desert sky itself, will be piped full of Kenny Loggins tunes, and our memories poisoned with 80s movie montages. Silence and Jehovah, deserts and dead space dust, lost in the oceans by the wrath of Poseidon, and Kenny Loggins. Oh, No one said it would be easy, Captain Adama. Or is it the heavenly Adama of the secret book of John or the Gospel of the Egyptians?
There is no going back. Our enemy pushes us on and on and on. And until we're strong enough or can find Earth and get help, we can never stop or turn away or look back.
Once upon an eternity, God had a dream he was a good man named Judas Iscariot, while a man named Judas Iscariot had a dream he was a good God named Yahweh. And then each woke up to a nightmare, realizing they were one and the same, and would never become what they hoped for, forever destined to be incarnations of the collective ignorance and evil of creation. And as they shuddered into realization, tearful that their comforting vision had expired, they stared right down at the barrel of the loaded cross of a wrathful cosmic Christ.
God is love. I don't love you.
And the nightmare continued, and it was reality, because it was the plan of the Pleroma. No matter how much Judas and God tried to find another dream to escape into, no matter how much they pleaded with Jesus to spare them from their kismet.
God made a covenant with Abraham that he would deliver the people. Am I the hand of God?
Fate is cruel to anyone who lingers in time and space, even for the greater gods and the greatest of gods. And that is just part of the Gospel of Judas, my beloved true seekers. And in our third series on this most notorious of Gnostic scriptures, brought to fame in 2006 by National Geographic, we take you further into the dream of the spirited Sethians and the nightmare of history's favorite kissing bandit and Orthodoxy's secret symbol for anti-Semitism.
Thus I clothe my naked villainy with old odd ends stolen forth from Holy Writ, and seem a saint when most I play the devil.
Again, the wonderful April DeConick joins us on this approximately Saturday, January 23rd, the year of our Demiurge 2010, as she did in our second installment of the Gospel of Judas on Aeon Byte number 73. Which I highly advise you to download, as well as our first series on Aeon Byte number 39. Our guest then was the great Marvin Meyer, one of the original translators of this heretical apocrypha, also an original proponent that the Gnostic Judas was a hero, and author of many lordly books, but the one you must have, without question, is his new translation of the Nag Hammadi Library.
Just awe-inspiring stuff.
As for April, she is the author of the 13th Apostle, which we discuss in this Eternal Now, specifically focusing on the second edition, as well as Voices of the Mystics and Recovering the Original Gospel of Thomas. She is also professor of biblical studies at Rice University in Houston, Texas, once upon a humanity the home of my mortal incarnation of Miguel Connor.
I work for Kaiser Soze.
For more information on April, I would suggest a visit to her electrifying blog, Preggers with Keen Scholarly and Hierophant Insights on Gnosticism and Ancient Religion You Won't Find Anywhere Else. She just has that ear Hans Jonas wrote about. Her blog can be enjoyed at forbiddengospels.blogspot.com.
Wow, he's very nice.
And the 13th Apostle's second edition is a sweet wet noodle slap, my beloved true seekers. Not just the usual smoothing out of intellectual wrinkles, small alterations of thesis and themes you find in other second printings. April adds two chapters that could stand on their own by the bonanza of information on not only the Gospel of Judas, but the Sethians themselves, which she will address fully in the interview, if you can survive my drivel without reaching for a Xanax milkshake. Let me explain. No, there is no time. Let me sum up.
Inconceivable!
As alluded and soon expanded upon, Judas is Jehovah incarnate in the flesh in the material world. You got it. Judas is the true son of God, while Jesus remains a salvific radiation of the Pleroma, descended to straighten him and the world out, including the 12 apostles, who are nothing but monkey manifestations of the Archons.
Everything about us is coming to an end.
I guess Marcion was right when he said that the 12 were but buffoons, and only trust the lone wolf St. Paul. And it's much worse than Judas just being yelled about, because not only is he the ruler of the universe, but dude also has Gnosis. How can you friggin' beat that? Your jaw may drop at this realization, maybe like when you witness Agent Smith absorb the powers of the Oracle, and become even mightier than the Matrix, and perhaps Neo himself.
Hear that, Mr. Anderson? That is the sound of inevitability. It is the sound of your death.
But that is not as unheard of as you might think. In Luke chapter 6, it says that even demons can believe in Jesus, which I find pretty amusing because it means that demons can be Christians. Then again, I guess that means Archons can be Gnostics, right? Oh, helter skelter and dang it.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm the devil!
Anywho, in the Acts of Andrew, we also have a scene in which a demon tells the apostles that he knows the mysteries of the Lord, meaning Pinhead figured out the weather chart of the Pleroma. So it happens. And it just means existence and transcendence are in more peril than you would think. But I have warned thee before that Gnosticism is the one faith that gives the most sense of urgency. That screams at you that not only things are code red, but that there are actually DEFCON 1 the more Gnosis you harvest. And that we better get busy with the celestial rescue operation of the broken shards of the first Sephiroth, residing in every sentient being in all dimensions, real or imagined, before we're swallowed by the angry black old sun fury of Jehovah and his angelic mafia.
The God does not like you, never wanted you. In all probability, he hates you.
As Martin Luther King once said, we're all under the same roof, but the house is on fire. I wonder if it was Jesus who lit it up. We don't need no water, let the mother bleep. I wonder if it's the right thing to do, or the right attitude to have.
This is blasphemy! This is madness!
But beyond Judas, we will learn some startling truths about the Sethians, my beloved truth seekers. Those enigmatic pre-Christian Gnostics, who really were the first to give the gods the finger, in a world where everyone was afraid of them. We'll learn of their practices, their history and evolution, their subculture, and why they raged against the heavens, and the early Christians, and the Jews, and even the pagans, all without losing their elegant philosophy and compassionate hearts. We'll learn that they were natural-born magicians, eccentric astrologers, and radical but sober thinkers with a razor-sharp, common-sense view of the multiverse.
Trust the gods, Leonidas.
I prefer you trusted your reason.
And it's important to note, as April points out, and most scholars have simply not wanted to face because it's just not rational enough, that without astrology or magic, Gnosticism isn't just devalued, but it isn't Gnosticism at all. And that includes the Valentinians and all other sects. Let's be realistic. In those ancient times, take away magic or astrology, and it would be like today taking away the internets and all types of phones and news outlets. Civilization would probably stand to a halt, my beloved truth seekers. And civilization did stand to a halt when magic and astrology were removed, once Christianity sent its 1,000 arrows against the enlightened King Leonidas of the Greco-Roman world.
Where are you going? I'm taking a vacation.
God doesn't take vacations, does he? Do ye?
Do you ever hear of the Dark Ages?
And as for you humanists, remember that magic and astrology were part and parcel of science back then. A trinity that gave us some of the most perceptive and greatest minds, philosophies, and art in all of history. Of course, the term magic is always hard to explain. One of those skunk words, you know, a term that means different things to different people, like pagan, cult, or gay.
Don't turn this into one of your big moral issues.
It's like the old saying, we practice religion, they practice magic. But the term magic comes from the root Greek word mag, which simply means to amplify, make larger. And that is what magic was meant to do in its original context, to expand one's consciousness, one's outer and inner vision, one's aura and soul, beyond the grasp of the gods and the other forces that kept us super glued to our dead animal bodies.
We will not live by your commandments, we're free!
Hey, there is no freedom without the law!
And that's just the tip of the Titans, you know what, that April will grant us on the Gospel of Judas and the Sethians. You might never regard Gnosticism in the same way, I tell ya. April, like Robert Price in our last program, will also give us a small State of the Union address on Gnosticism, dealing with many of the same issues, like whether Gnosticism should be discarded, was Gnosticism a pre-Christian movement, and other miscellanea. And like Robert, she's not happy with many of you, and you might be surprised this time at who she's not happy with. Let me give you a hint. You wear the same priest's clothes that would have infuriated the Sethians and their disdain for apostolic tradition, or intricate costumes while you perform your little spells that would also infuriate the Sethians because they had that sense of urgency many modern Gnostics don't have. They knew that the only alternative was to, yes, rage against the heavens.
The time has come for me to meet my Maker and to repay him in kind for all that he's done.
The world is far worse than Maya, far worse than Newton's clock machine, far worse than Talbot's holographic soup. It's the nightmare of both a man and God that wish for something better.
The perfect world is a dream that your primitive cerebrum kept trying to wake up from.
But hey, follow your own path. Always follow your bliss. What do I know? I'm just a voice in the wilderness that usually ends up choking on too many locusts of self-delusion and ends up often mentally diabetic by the honey of his own deliriums. No matter what, write your own gospel and live your own myth. You'll be fine. It's just that some of us have decided we're going to the front lines with Seth, Jesus, Alogenes, Noria, and the other apostles of light. We're going down in a blaze of unglory.
Whenever there is any doubt, there is no doubt. That's the first thing they teach you.
Who taught you?
I don't remember. That's the second thing they teach you.
But enough of my drivel. April DeConick on the second edition of the 13th Apostle and a complete new dimension on Sethianism. And then everybody can cut foot loose. Steiner. Steiner. This is the Aeon Byte interview, and with us we have always the great pleasure of having April DeConick to discuss the second edition of the 13th Apostle and new revelations on Sethianism and other sundries. How are you doing today, April?
I'm doing very well and happy to be here.
Oh, always such a pleasure to have you. April, can you give us a very brief recap of your thesis for the 13th Apostle?
Certainly. I've been working on the Gospel of Judas, and as you know, it's a fairly fragmentary gospel, and it was reconstructed and published in 2006 by National Geographic, and we were told by them that the text very clearly portrayed Judas as a hero, and when I started looking at the Coptic text itself and some of the translation and also even transcription choices that the team had made, I noticed that my own transcription and translation was very different from theirs, and that in fact Judas in this text is called a demon, and he is connected to the demiurge figure, Yaldabaoth, who is also called in this text Saklos and Nebro. So my thesis essentially is that the Sethian Christians who composed this document did not understand Judas as a Gnostic hero, but instead as a great demon, even who would be associated with the ruler of this world, the demon Yaldabaoth.
And before we get into more of the meat of the matter, I guess in Judas's case, the blood of the matter, last year, missing fragments of the Gospel of Judas were added to the text at Chapman University. Did this reconstruction bring any major changes to your overall thesis, or did we discover anything new?
Well, this is a good question, and actually, this is just now in the process of happening. There are some fragments still of the Gospel of Judas that haven't come really into the scholarly world yet. They've been being held in a legal battle. My understanding is that is being resolved now, and in November in St. Louis, in New Orleans, at the Society of Biblical Literature meeting, 2009, so this just happened, Professor Marvin Meyer gave a talk in which he shared his and Gregor Verse's transcription and translation of those fragments. They were able to do this from some photographs that they had access to. We've been told that the fragments themselves are eventually going to come to them, and that there will be some sort of look at those by a number of scholars in order to make transcriptions and translations and get them incorporated into the Gospel of Judas that we've already reconstructed. At this time, my reading of those does in no way change my thesis. It in fact supports it. At the end of the Gospel, we now know that it's Jesus who ascends at the end. It's not Judas. This was, of course, a major point that was being used in their first publications, that Judas was a Gnostic hero who was transfigured. And in this case, it's clear that that's no longer the case. So we'll have to see as we work through the all the fragments. In fact, this semester in my graduate seminar that we're going to be doing just that. But at this point, I do not have photographs. All I have are transcriptions that have been provided by Professor Meyer and Professor Verst.
Yeah, and for the listener, you can go to Chapman University's website and get a couple of the Marvin Meyer translations or what he's giving us right now.
Right.
Again, scholars obviously will have to look at the real thing or the closest thing to the real thing to really understand it. It just gets more interesting.
It sure does. It's very exciting.
And in your second edition of the 13th Apostle, it has some amazing revelations. And it has oddly to do with astrology right. Instead of theology. Guess we can call it astrotheology.
Yeah, astrotheology. There you go. I like that term.
Can you tell us how the unusual and opposing manners Gnostics viewed the heavens, and you give the two opposing views of the Valentinians and the Sethians, and why it's important in understanding the Gnostic Judas?
For years, scholars have not really investigated the astrological connections to the Gnostic tradition. When they looked at the materials, they basically have understood the astrological tradition to be kind of a late secondary overlay of the Gnostic tradition, that the Gnostics were confused about the astrology, that it wasn't really central to their worldview. My work on the Gospel of Judas and going back and really digging through ancient Egyptian astrological lore, Hellenistic lore, Chaldean lore, I am finding that the astrological tradition, in fact, is central to the Gnostic worldview, and that the Gnostic worldview won't work, at least in the ancient world, without it. The reason for this is that the Gnostics understood this universe as a place that they had to escape or leave in order to get to another world that was beyond our universe, where the real God lived. And this cosmos was created, and it had various layers to it. It had a celestial sphere, which consisted of a number of heavens. And usually you have seven heavens, and in those they placed the seven ancient planets, which also included the sun and the moon, which they saw understood as rotating around the earth. And then they had an eighth sphere, which was the sphere of the zodiac or the fixed stars. And in the Sethian tradition, they would sometimes place the Yaldabaoth god in that eighth sphere. Okay, so just sort of hang on to that for a minute. And then below the celestial sphere, so in the sublunar realm, was what they understood to be the hells. And the hells did also go under the earth, like the old, Tartarus and so forth. But in this period, the hells are also extending into the air around the earth up to the sublunar sphere. And in this sphere, the devil and so forth rule. And they understood there to be five hells, or not really five hells, more five compartments of hell, and a major demon ruled each of these locations. So overall, they end up with 12 rulers, seven of the heavens and five of these hells. And then they have the head god in that eighth sphere. So they have 13 kind of demonic gods that are ruling the universe. When the person is born, they understood the spirit, which came from the world beyond, to drop down through this universe and become incarnated in a human body. And as it did that, it collects a soul, which is the rational self. And that soul is created along with the physical body by all of these demons that are ruling the skies and the planets. And the kind of soul you get and the kind of body you get depends on the location of those planets at your birth moment. So this is the horoscope. And this birth moment also cast your fate. And fate wasn't so much understood to be like every movement or thing you would do in your life, but your fate involved when you were born, which then is going to mean your physical condition and social location, and also your death, how you would die. And these were determined by the way the planets and the gods who were these planets were positioned and so forth at the moment of your birth. If you want to get out of this universe, you have to basically move out of these planetary spheres. You have to get through these hells. You have to give back all of the parts of your soul that you received from these demons and escape. And so what the Gnostics were doing in their rituals is that they were creating an avenue through the stars in order to escape this world. Your different Gnostic groups are mapping that route in different ways. Those are the secrets that you're learning when you're initiated into the various Gnostic communities, is this route of escape. Now, what is really fascinating with the Gospel of Judas is that it is assuming this, and what it's telling you in this text is who these planets are. And it is associating with these planetary rulers, the 12 apostles, and Judas, who is the Yaldabaoth ruler of them all. It is also a text that understands Judas as an apostate whose fate, whose death, has been predetermined by his birth. And there's nothing he can do to escape that fate. In the text, he has this dream where he sees himself being stoned, and he comes to a place in the beyond, and he wants to enter into it. And so he understands the dream to mean that he's going to get to enter this great place when he is stoned. And Jesus tells him, sorry, but that's not what's going to happen. You're going to be stuck in the 13th realm as the Yaldabaoth ruler. That's your fate. Just live with it. So this is what is going on in terms of astrology in this particular text.
Yeah, and you're right, for example, that the Valentinians, specifically Theodotus, taught that the apostles were substituted the 12 signs of the zodiac once you were initiated.
Right.
So you're actually ruled by the apostles, which are benign creatures. But the Sethians believed in this counterpart correspondence.
Right.
Which basically, does that mean that these archons actually had their doppelgangers
exactly.
in the material world, and that's what Judas is, the doppelganger of the demiurge?
That is absolutely right. And we see both of these views operating in our text, but this is the interesting thing. The view of the Valentinians is very much like the other Christians were viewing astrology at this time. And in fact, we have this very notion mentioned by Zeno, where he states that at baptism you are freed from the old fate. Because you are going to enter a new fate that Christ is going to rule. But the Valentinian tradition is, and this gets a little complicated in that my understanding of Gnosticism is so changed because of the Gospel of Judas. What we've got is different groups having a different kind of relationship with the Christian church and the synagogues as well. Now, the Valentinians are what, in this time period, I would call very, and you see them doing both of these things. There's something like a lodge-like movement or a reform movement. In other words, they identify themselves with Christianity, with traditional Christianity of the time. They're attending church normally and so forth, but they also have some sort of like special meetings that they're going to where they're doing these initiations that I spoke about a little earlier. But their self-identity is Christian. They're not reading the scripture yet in quite as transgressive of manner as they do later in time as the Christian church begins to expel them and they become unwelcome. Why in this period when they're still very much part of the Christian church, they're thinking about astrology very much like other Christians are thinking about it. Now, when you get into this Christian Sethian tradition that's being represented by the Gospel of Judas, we've got a different sort of social relationship going on with the Christian church. These people have become separatists. They do not view themselves as traditional Christians anymore. They do view themselves as being the perfect Christians, but the traditional Christianity they feel is so corrupt that it can't be redeemed. And that's really what the Gospel of Judas is about, because they are really critiquing the apostolic church here. They are saying, look, guys, Judas is the main demon who's running your church, and the apostles who you're following are his minions. They're the doppelgangers of the archons who are, these evil characters who are associated with the planets and your fate. So if you want to, not be under their fate anymore, you've got to leave the Christian church and come and join us who know the truth and know the avenue out of here.
Yeah, that's very interesting, because one of the arguments is that the Gnostics were, these rebellious people. They were like the Johnny Cashes or Elvis Presleys of their time. But what you're saying is basically they were not. They were forced to become that.
Yes, very much so.
Once they were, once the polemics began against them and they were, like you said, thrown out or criticized in the churches.
Right. And one of the difficulties with really understanding ancient Gnosticism is that, when we look back at it, the Gnostics got grouped together not only with themselves, and they were very diverse, had very diverse opinions among themselves, but they also get categorized in with other forms of Christianity that were considered eventually heretical, but were not necessarily Gnostic. And so it's a very confusing category. And so there have been scholars who have been trying to argue, let's not use this category because it's not useful, that these people were basically just other Christians. And I was willing to go along with that to some extent until I came across this Gospel of Judas, in which we have a text that very vehemently is countering the apostolic church. I mean, it sees the apostolic church as wrong and itself as the true form of Christianity. What I think we have going on in the second century and the third century even is various groups of Jews and Christians who had different relationships with the traditional church and synagogue. Some of them were willing, like to even today, to self-identify with Christianity and Judaism in its traditional sense, to attend church, to attend synagogue, but they didn't feel that they were getting everything spiritual they needed there. And so they would form these groups in which they would do further study. They would have initiation sort of rituals in order to deepen their understandings of the mysteries of God and so forth. And those groups had different tensions and relationships with the church and synagogue. So in some of them were lodge-like movements, which were very much hooked in to the traditional religion. Then you get groups that were more reform movements, where they're like, well, I still think Christianity is great, the traditional Christianity is great, but we need to tweak it here and there. And so they started opening maybe their own church, like maybe Marcus was doing, Marcus the Valentinian. You know, he had his own church going on that he was running. But the tension between he and the tradition is growing, but it's not really full-blown yet. And then you get movements that are very tense. They're interpreting the literature, the scripture, in ways that are very transgressive, really upside down compared to the traditional Jewish or Christian interpretation of the text. And these people are not attending the traditional synagogue and church anymore, not at all. And they have created their own environment of worship, their own rituals, and so forth, although they still see themselves as Jewish or Christian, but as the true Jew or Christian and the traditional Christian as being misled. By the end of the third century, the tensions among those sorts of groups had risen to such a point that the Christians in the traditional church are now kicking these people out that are still trying to hang into the to attend church and so forth and want to identify with Christianity. They're really making these separations by this time, because what we see at the end of the third century, even in the middle of the third century, are complaints in the Gnostic text that they're being persecuted. Also, the development of handbooks for Gnostic information. And here I'm thinking of the books of Geo and the Pista Sophia, early fourth century. These are church handbooks that are being created by what I would call your first Gnostics. These are people who are identifying themselves as Gnostics, not as Christians, not as Jews, not as any other religion, but as Gnostic. They are forming what I would call a new religious movement by this time. Very eclectic. They're drawing from all sorts of different religious traditions. Think of Mani in the third century drawing from Buddhism, Persian religion, as well as from Judaism and Christianity, and they're creating these Gnostic religions. In the case of Manichaeism, it really thrived and survived, and also Mandeism, because they moved east into a social and political environment in which they were able to survive for a while and really grow. Where in the West, you end up having Constantine coming on board and you get, Christianity starting to define itself very much in very different ways from the Gnostics. And so the Gnostics aren't in a healthy environment here, and their religion really has trouble surviving in that environment.
Another thing I noticed that was very interesting about your book is that you bring the fact that the myth of Yaldabaoth is not solely based on Jehovah, but is actually based also on an Egyptian supreme being.
Well, yeah, you know, again, these people are eclectic. The traditions that they're using, many of these people are Egyptians. I mean, at that time, who were very familiar with Egyptian magical traditions and Hermetic traditions. And what you have in this time period, and again, I don't know what word to use. We use pagan for it, but there's all sorts of problems with this. But you in this pagan environment, you have a magical tradition in which, if you want, let's say you have a stomach ache, if you want healing from that stomach ache, you could go to the temple, the Egyptian temple. You could perhaps find a practice of healing there by using magic. They would make a gem for you, for instance, which would have on it what I'm calling the astral lord. He was figured in many different ways, and I show pictures of these many different sorts of ways that he was pictured. But he's the big guy that governs the celestial spheres and controls your fate and how how you were created in terms of your body and so forth. And remember that each of these demons is somehow connected to one of your body parts, is giving you that, created that part of your body and that part of your soul. So if I've got a stomach ache and I can know the name of the god who gave me my stomach, I might be able to persuade that god to heal my stomach ache. And so they would use magic sometimes for medicinal reasons. They would invoke the astral lord, who was the lord they feared. I think one of the things that is really misunderstood about ancient religion is that they loved their gods. There's no love relationship here between these gods. These gods were powerful. They could do whatever they wanted to do to you, and you had to appease them. And when you see things on these gems, like, you know, the holy name Abrasax or something like that.
Or Michael.
Or the holy Michael.
He became the stellar god.
Right. You know, or the holy Yaldabaoth. This is not, there. It's like saying, good dog, you know, don't bite me. And, you know, there's a lot of fear here. And they're using magic and these gems in order to try to control their medical condition, their fate, their love relationships, all sorts of things. I mean, we have recipe books. We have all sorts of information about ancient magic. So we actually know quite well what was going on. And we have one real very, very interesting piece that somebody had made that they wore as a pendant, that said, you know, by invoking your holy name, you know, I can control what's going to happen to me. You know, we know how they thought it worked. And the idea is if I know the name of the demon who ruled that body part, or the name of the astral demon, which is a secret name, if I know his secret magical name, I can control that demon. So it's very, very important for them to know the names of these characters and their secret names, because the name to them was power to control that demon.
Yeah, and this leads to the other great discovery that you found, very amazing. Could you tell us about how you found this magical gem and how it supported your view of Judas?
Yeah, it was utterly stunning. I was in my office, and this was not this last fall, but the fall before. And I had a new graduate student named Grant Adamson, and he was working on some gem catalogs for his own research. And he came into my office, and he said, "Professor DeConick, I found something in a gem catalog that I think you might want to look at. I don't know if it's really important or not, but take a look at it." And so he showed me this a page in the gem catalog in which you have a gem with the astral lord character on the one side, who is portrayed exactly like the astral lord we have on the ophite gem that has the name Yaldabaoth on it, okay? And on the back is the name of the god Judas. I was just stunned by this. So I started doing some research on the history of its interpretation and so forth. And, you know, there was some work done very early on in the 1800s in which, you know, they were trying to make arguments that this was, you know, Judas Iscariot that was being referred to. But this didn't make sense with the literature because, you know, Epiphanius tells us that he was a Gnostic hero. Why would they have the demon on the one side and then the Gnostic hero's name on the other? It didn't match what these gems normally have, which is the demon pictured on the one side with often his name in various perforations, and then in the back is his magical name as well. And of course, with my work that I've been doing on the Gospel of Judas, here I had a literary text that was telling me that the Gnostics had identified Judas with the Yaldabaoth god, the demon god. So it really wasn't until we discovered the Gospel of Judas that we could make sense of this gem.
And how did the Judas evolve into a demon? Don't you write that it starts way back with the tribe of Judah and being correlated to a lion?
Exactly.
Did it slowly evolve throughout time?
Yes, because what you have is, well, first of all, what you got in religious traditions is intersections, a network of ideas that people bring together. When they do this, and it's just sort of our natural process, the way our brains operate, they make these sort of connections and something new comes out the other end. Now, we already knew that Michael, the angel Michael, was being associated with this astral lord on gems. They would also use other angels as well, but Michael was one that they really correlated. And they seem to have done this from their reading of some passages from the actually not Hebrew Bible, but the Septuagint, in which they understood a correlation between Judah and the Lion of God and Michael the angel. And so those get wrapped together and they begin to understand this again on these gems, the astral Lord as being Michael. So I think then you have also the New Testament traditions where Judas is called, has a demon, controlled by Satan and all of this. And he has the name Judas, which is correlates with Judah. All of this kind of gets hooked and packaged together by the Gnostics, and they then make the leap to identifying Judas Iscariot with this Yaldabaoth Michael god. So it's fascinating.
And going a little away from astrology, what are some other nuances you discovered that point to Judas being an archon and not a hero? I guess starting with the Coptic word for ruling, which is very different than the Greek loan word, isn't it?
It is, but it's the same. They do both. I mean, they do both using the, you know, the Greek loan word and also the Coptic translation of that. But but in this text, Jesus tells Judas that he's going to rule the 13th aeon. This means that he's going to be the ruler or the archon of that realm. So, I mean, the language is real clear there.
And also, what must not be understood is that the 13th aeon is not seen as something good, as many have positive, and the Sethians viewed the whole concept of aeon differently than other Gnostics, didn't they?
Well, see, this is the thing, and I'm really tired of people getting mixed up by this. It's really quite simple. The Gnostic groups, depending on who you are, understand the cosmic setup a little bit differently. In the Sethian tradition, our Sethian texts are really clear in this period that the universe is divided between that it has a ruler who's the god of the 13 aeons. That's the Yaldabaoth. He's got seven guys under him and five demons in the abysses. Okay, this is clearly mapped out in Holy Book of the Gospel of Egyptians, the Holy Book, and also in the Apocryphon of John. And now we've got it in the Gospel of Judas. So this is just the way that these people understood their world. The text that you're referring to in terms of a 13 aeon that is outside this world is Pisistophia, which is a 4th century document. It's an eclectic document. It's not Sethian. It's a combination of Manichaean, Sethian, Valentinian, Christian, Jewish traditions. This has a very different layout of the cosmos and the other world beyond this cosmos. And this cosmos consists of 12 aeons. And then you have a 13th aeon, which is outside of this cosmos. And in that is also a negative aeon. It's not a happy place. It's a place of judgment. And it's ruled by the grandfather, or actually the father, well, I get to kind of the father of Yaldabaoth, I guess. I mean, he's the one that is responsible for you know, the Yaldabaoth god coming into this cosmos down here. And then you have a world beyond that, that is the holy treasury, the treasury of light, the place of good. So you've got a real different setup there. The reason that the 13th aeon is, we don't have the same setup as Pisistophia in the Gospel of Judas, is that the 13th aeon in the Gospel of Judas is in this cosmos. It is a place where a star is. Stars are only in this cosmic realm. They are not outside of this universe. So the 13th aeon is a cosmic realm in this universe. It is not outside of here. And so it's very simple. And I really hope that this gets cleared up and that people can get their heads around this.
So needless to say, you don't buy Marvin Meyer's argument that Judas is sort of a parallel of Pistisophia, you know, mourning in the 13th aeon.
No, I do not. He is not Pistisophia. He does not come from the divine realm. He's not stuck here, and he's not being released from this realm, this cosmic realm. His place is here in this cosmos, and he is understood to become the demon ruler of this cosmos, and that's as far as he's going to get. And in the end, his rule, I mean, this is going to be destroyed. And this is the fate that he cries about. The text talks about him weeping. It talks about Jesus laughing at him and thinking, I think this is the laughter of that we find in the, you know, the Hebrew Bible, of God laughing at his enemies being defeated. Judas is not Sophia here.
So no matter what angle, we can't make him a hero.
We cannot make
no
him
matter
Sophia
how much we try.
Right.
You write that the Sethians obviously had a dislike for the 12 apostles, seeing them as incarnations again of the heavens and the whole correspondence theory. Obviously, they had the same argument as Marcion did, or same attitude as Marcion.
Mm-hmm.
But the Sethians seem not to have an affinity to Paul like Marcion's. Did the Sethians have any known leadership or veneration for masters or anything like that besides Seth? Or were they just, again, just wild Johnny Cashes of their era?
You know, this is a super good question. They seem to have leaders because Plotinus knows them. I mean, they seem to be a group of people that, you know, Plotinus is aware of, that are attending his school. I wouldn't call them Johnny Cashes. I'd call them the intellectuals of the period. I mean, they're the ones that are studying the philosophy. They're the ones that are studying the astrology. So I don't think they're rogue at all. I think they're very much the intellectuals. They are trying to take the intellectual information of the time. In other words, how the intellectuals were talking about the universe and understanding our place in it, and make sense of the Bible with that, and so they're reading the Bible in very different ways than the traditional religions are doing. So
you would say their motives were very altruistic. They really
right.
wanted to help and to make things better for everybody.
Yes, absolutely. They were the people who were saying, look, we know this is true about our world. The philosophers tell us this, and, you know, philosophy and science are kind of joint things, enterprises at this time. I mean, you know, astrology is telling us things. Ancient religions all tell us this is the way our world operates, but how do we make that work with our scriptures? And so that's what they're doing. They're trying to make the scripture make sense with their contemporary worldview. in some ways, like theologians today want to make the biblical text make sense to evolution. You know, and so they want to interpret the you know, days as eras, or, you know, I mean, things like that. And this is the kind of thinking that the Gnostics were doing. They're saying, how do we take what we know is to be true about our world from science and philosophy and astrology and match it and make the Bible make sense? And the only way that they could figure out to do it was to make the God of the Bible, that is the Yahweh God of the Bible, to be the God who rules this world. I mean, this is the world he created, and he's the astral lord. He's the one that rules over all of it. And in their eyes, that ruler then had to be a demon. And of course, when they read the scripture and they hear that, you know, Yahweh calls himself the angry and jealous God who punishes, you know, generations of children for their father's sins, and who, you know, rips children apart with a bear for, you know, calling his prophet a baldy, you know, they start to have some support for their position.
And you wrote, or I saw in your blog, the title about postmodernism and historical criticism.
Mm-hmm.
What exactly is this debate?
This is a big question you're asking me. Let me try to see where to start to unpack it.
It's got to be asked because it's a, you know, it's a continuation and beginning of further debate.
It is. You know, one of the things that, you know, historical criticism has known for a long time. I mean, when I was being trained as a young graduate student, my professors were telling me this, and it was just quite evident that the perspective of the interpreter, that is me as a historian, is going to influence the kind of history that I will write about my subject. The big concern for us as historians is that we're able to detach ourselves from our own faith traditions so that we aren't trying to recreate or find support for our own faith traditions and how we are reading the ancient literature and reconstructing history. Okay, so this is sort of one of the things that I learned as a young graduate student, how important it is to separate one's own beliefs, own personal religious beliefs, and put them aside and study the ancient religion just, I mean, as much as a historian, you know, would study, you know, Tacitus or what have you. What has happened in, you know, the last years is that philosophers have also been talking about this, and the discussion has moved to the point that people have been entertaining that, well, you can't ever write an objective history, that all history you're going to be writing about is subjective, so therefore we really can't know what happened historically, and that the real value of any text is the interpreter's value, that there's no way to understand an authorial intent and so forth. Now, this is a very troubling sort of development because it calls into question history. And in fact, can we ever know anything, any facts at all, or is everything always up in the air? What has happened is that people have been criticizing the way that scholars have traditionally been operating in terms of methods that they've been using, and saying that, you know, well, the methods really can't tell us anything because everything that we do is so subjective that we really aren't getting, there's no way for us to get objective information from using our historical methods. Now, this is a position that I don't entertain, but I'll talk about that in a minute. But I do want to say that one of the things, that the results of this, is that I'm really concerned about our graduate training now, because what I'm seeing is papers being delivered at SBL and books being written in which people are moving to interpret texts from any position that they want, and not doing any really hardcore historical work anymore, not looking at the empirical data, being trained in languages, being trained in the culture of the time. And so I'm worried about the future of biblical studies because we're moving more and more into sort of a philosophical interpretation of the materials where almost anything goes, rather than what I would consider to be a sound historical model, which is interested in empirical data. In other words, work like we're doing on the Gospel of Judas, where you've got a manuscript sitting in front of you. You need to get it transcribed. You need to get a translation worked out that's a critical translation. You need to understand that text within a context of other texts that were written in the same, you know, the same time period, and see if what kinds of thought links and historical links there may be, and to really work through the materials in those ways. I do think there is authorial intent in any, I know when I write something, I have authorial intent, and I imagine that people in the ancient world, when they wrote something, had an authorial intent. And I think that if you can map cognitively that the author's not only narrative, but also his connections to other narratives of the time, and his the way other people were using similar ideas, and I think that you can get very close to understanding what that text was intended to do. And so that's what I'm working on right now.
Hey, bro, I definitely empathize with scholars, because it must be hard. I mean, the Nag Hammadi Library and the Gospel of Judas are really very recent.
Right.
But you've got already hundreds of years of Gnostic tradition.
Right.
You have all these churches, Neo-Templar, Neo-Cathar movements,
right.
Theosophical Society interpreting the Pistisophia.
Right.
So you've already got things stacked up against you. I mean, even the Gospel of Judas, there is already a tradition of people having a preconceived notion of wanting Judas to be a hero.
Right.
So before you even open the Gospel of Judas interpreted, you've already got that to face.
Exactly.
So it must be hard.
You know, and this, and I do want to say this. I think that there probably was a group, maybe even more than one, by the time that Epiphanius is writing, maybe as early as Pseudo-Tertullian, that did understand Judas as a hero. Both Epiphanius and Pseudo-Tertullian understand and those people to be the Cainites. What happens with the Gospel of Judas is that it ends up getting connected in Epiphanius with the Cainites. This is the first time in history that that happens. And he does it because he is basically editing together a source he has that Pseudo-Tertullian also used on the Cainites, with the information that he has on the Gospel of Judas from Irenaeus, who in fact does not associate this text with the Cainites. The whole association with the Cainites in Irenaeus is a late scribal subtitle that got stuck into a manuscript, into the manuscript tradition of the Irenaean material. So it's not until Epiphanius that you get this connection, and he does it because he's basically taken these two sources he's using and hooked them together because they both talked about Judas. But, you know, if you just read Epiphanius, you can see that the Cainites, and again, there is debate among scholars whether this group actually existed or not, but that the Cainites' understanding of Judas, it doesn't match anything in the Gospel of Judas that we have. Nothing.
Yeah, I guess with the church fathers, you both have to put on a detective hat and a psychologist hat when reading them, right?
Yes, yes. And you have to be very careful about what they're doing with their sources, because Epiphanius is hooking those two things together because of the commonality of Judas. And so what he does is he then makes the Cainites be the authors of the Gospel of Judas, when in fact they were not. Pseudo-Tertullian mentions the Cainites and their view of Judas, but that source never mentions the Gospel of Judas. Irenaeus mentions the Gospel of Judas, but doesn't mention the Cainites, and nor does he say that Judas is, you know, being understood to be a great hero in this text either. He says that he's the disciple who, you know, is given knowledge, but, you know, we don't have him he's not being portrayed as a great Gnostic hero here.
One other little debate that keeps going on is whether Gnosticism was pre-Christian or a Christian phenomenon. I'm guessing you stand that Gnosticism came out of the Christian milieu.
Actually, no. I have a very complicated view of that, of course. Because, I mean,
of course, yes.
But, you know, the long and short of it is that it looks to me like the origins of the Gnostic tradition come from the Hermetic Lodge in Alexandria or somewhere else in Egypt. But it's a Hermetic lodge somewhere where there are Jews and probably some Samaritans who are attending. I think that's the origins. Eventually, Christians end up wandering in here, and so you start to get a Christianization of the tradition as well. And again, these people, I wouldn't really call the tradition Gnosticism until you have the new religious movement happening in the late 3rd and early 4th centuries, when they are no longer defining themselves as Christians or Jews. So it's complicated, but I think we need that kind of complication in order to make sense of the sources that we have.
But what about when people say, you look at the apocalypse of Adam, which seems very non-Christian, it's also Sethian.
Right.
Doesn't that further legitimize the presentation of Gnosticism, however elastic the term is, pre-Christian? Or again, is this a reaction to the Christian church?
No, I think that the Sethian tradition was pre-Christian. Okay, I think it started in the first century in that Hermetic lodge. And so, I mean, and so you have to imagine this is very, very tradition. I mean, there would be these Jewish Gnostics who are off doing their own thing. You've got Christians that are joining in, and then, you know, they also start to break off and do their own thing, and they start to heavily Christianize the tradition, so that by 150 with the Gospel of Judas, you've got them, you know, a very Christianized Sethian tradition there. So it's complicated. You can't think of it as linear, but as multiple. And you have these Jewish Gnostics who continue kind of mapping their tradition that way. Then you get Christian Gnostics that begin developing the Sethian tradition in another way. And you also get, you know, so we're in the Hermetic Lodge, you get these pagans mapping the tradition in their way. And so, you know, you get these Platonizing treatises that aren't Jewish or Christian as well. So all three things are happening, but I think it all starts in this Hermetic Lodge where you've got some Jews and Samaritans who are attending. And they begin talking about the Hebrew Bible, probably the Greek translation of it, trying to relate that to the Platonic and the Middle Platonic cosmology that's coming out of the philosophical schools at the time.
Wow, this is fascinating. Now I understand how you can get so excited about your work and work so hard.
Yeah.
Because you've only just begun.
I've only just begun, and there's so much more to do. And my next big project, after I finish my book on Sex and the Serpent about sexuality in early Christianity, my next big project is to do the Gnostics and their Gospels. And so I'm just going to march through all the material, and I'm going to lay it out and show, yeah, it's complicated, but we can make sense of this.
I guess that's all the time we have today, and I'd like to thank you very much for coming on Aeon Byte for this very stimulating conversation.
Thank you. I'm really excited to have been able to join you today.
Oh, as excited as I am. Well, you have yourself a good day now,
right.
And thank you very much again.
And gnosis to all.
Gnosis to all. Thank you.
Bye. All right. Bye-bye.
And there you have it, my beloved true seekers. The oh-so-cool April DeConick on the Gospel of Judas and New Revelations on Sethianism. From her book, The 13th Apostle, which should have a hallowed place in your pantheon of books on Gnosticism and ancient religions. And again, you should bookmark her blog, forbiddengospels.blogspot.com, as well as download any of her appearances on Aeon Byte. Oh, and as for the Egyptian supreme being that the Sethians partly base Yaldabaoth on, representing a highest decan or fixed star in the constellation of Leo, he was called Shar Shanubis, or just Shanubis, and he had the body of a snake and the, you got it, the head of a lion. And beyond all her wisdom gathered from that special ear, one must constantly tune to grasp the endless, silky music strands of Gnosticism. I'm glad April mentioned that the ancients didn't particularly like the gods. And this doesn't include the Greco-Roman worldview, if you take into consideration many pre-Columbian, Oriental, and, I'm going to say it, Lovecraftian traditions. Oliver Stone gave us that puke call Alexander, but the one good scene is when Philip takes the young and oddly Irish Alexander the Great into the catacombs and reveals to him the reality that man secretly hates all the gods. They just keep their resentment under their hats. I mean, just read the Book of Numbers. The Israelites were mostly pissed off at Jehovah, constantly whining and bitching and moaning because they had left ancient Kemet with their aeonic alchemists, Schrodinger pharaohs, and laughing hermeticists. They weren't happy, and Jehovah wasn't happy with them. He did plenty of his own complaining and rolling of his eyes. He should have just turned the car around and taken them back home to Egypt. And I believe deep in our hearts, every human being, even the ones stoned on New Age philosophy and hippified Kumbaya theology, feel the same way. Part of Gnosis is being completely honest to the point it shatters the mirrors of your perception. The Buddha was right. Suffering has no reward, but a lot of calluses and scar tissue. Only the release of suffering matters. And we're all going to suffer as long as we're married to the material, and that includes the gods. You may see this as nihilistic and existentialist, and you may be partly right. The difference is that when you truly face, with open childlike eyes, the darkness that encompasses most of reality, when the abyss stares right into you, and you're brave enough not to blink, when the dawn never seems to come, is when you'll notice something wonderful. The emptiness, the desolation, is so filled with snowflakes of light all around, the tears of Hagia Sophia, all the living souls in the multiverse, all over, almost blotting creation, lighting it up, sparkling with such a timid but sharp force, it might shatter your heart and bring you to weep. You'll see them in an elegant dance, emitting a silent song of angelic lives remembered. And that's when you'll discover true compassion, accept true heroism, find a pattern in their symphony that begins your journey in rescuing these snowflakes of light that you are part of, for you are one with them. And take them all into yourself, and take yourself and all of them all the way back to your home of homes. It will feel like that scene when the shoplifter Wayona Ryder dances under the ice created by Johnny Depp and Edward Scissorhands. True wakefulness, true awareness, true innocence, and true freedom. And there might even be hope for Judas and Jehovah, my beloved true seekers. Who knows? Can fate be fool, I wonder? I wonder. Unless Kenny Loggins ruins it all with one of his soundtrack songs, Highway to the Danger Zone. What can I say? I am, and I am Abraxas, broadcasting at the Virtual Alexandria through the godabovegod.com. The road is ended, the song is over, thought I'd have something more to say. But don't cultivate any troubles, my beloved true seekers, because like heaven above you, the spy that love you, I'm keeping all of your secrets safe with me tonight. hello, and goodbye as always.